He's been working on this for a while now. We've got some of our coaches here. Coach Ray Cote, leading scorer in the Mexican Hockey League. Member of the National Hockey Team. The National Team. Edmonton Oilers played for,
13 games.
Yeah. Who would be making tens of millions of dollars right now as a 30-goal scorer with the New Jersey Devils. We've got a wealth of experience. Gord Baldwin, who actually one of three hockey players that I know that actually did his degree while playing hockey. Not a lot of people know that a lot of these leagues will actually pay for your university degree. Even fewer actually take it up and go through with it. But Gord played for over 10 years. And then Kelly Eskew, my right-hand man, we played college hockey together. Also played on the national team together. Kelly's been working with NHL teams and top prospects for the last 10 plus years. But we do have a wealth of experience as far as coaches go. We've got some amazing people in the city that are really coming out in droves to get behind this, and it's a pretty exciting day. So I got to thank you guys. It takes a lot of courage to do something different, to do something that's really kind of unique. And we're going to go through a bit of a presentation. It's not going to take more than 20 minutes. We're going to open it up to some questions. And really, we're at your service to kind of answer, what this thing is, why on earth we're doing it, and hopefully get you guys excited about this, because it's really something special, especially for your kids and for generations to come. This is something it's a great day for hockey. To have you guys here is it's a great start. All right, you want to get started with this? So, this actually did not just dream up in a bar nap and somewhere. This has been, and all of us, not only have we played extensively here in North America, but around the world. And we've been very privileged to see and be part of a lot of different programs. Gosh, over 40 years ago, there was a great study by Mr. Kingston, and he went into, he also had been around the world, looked at a lot of different models, especially youth development models, and just came up with some pretty alarming and maybe counterintuitive findings on just how much kids are actually playing during that 60-minute period, how much they're actually touching the ball. And again, this is 40 years ago that this has been around. And I don't know if you guys are somewhat privy to what's happening in the U.S. or in other parts of the world, but there's a huge focus on small area games, lots of repetition, lots of puck touches, and just making the game fun. But we've known about this for a long time. It's amazing that all of us have to get here on this first night to actually talk about a league. It's some sort of rogue league that's coming out of nowhere. It's so revolutionary, but this has really been around for a long time. It's been done very successfully in a lot of different parts of the world. It's pretty interesting. So what we've done is we've effectively changed the progression period compared to what's now available. We are focusing in, and we're trying to simplify this as much as we can, make this about the kids as much as we possibly can. But the pyramid is really based on four different levels. The discovery level is pretty self-evident. That's something they do really well here at Winsport, and we're working with them to really help these kids start getting on skates, getting comfortable, and then moving up and playing some games, playing some hockey, and just starting to enjoy the game there. What we're doing very differently, as you guys are obviously well aware of, is we're changing this now into a 3-on-3, and we're changing it. We're not only making the surface age appropriate, like we do in every other aspect of kids' lives. I mean, their clothes, they don't wear adult clothes, they don't ride on adult bikes. This is something that's as evident and as blatantly obvious for us. But we're bringing the surface down to an age-appropriate level. And then with the 3-on-3 component, the interesting thing is, and you get a lot of this question, and I'm not sure if you guys have this burning in your mind too, but how do kids transition from 3-on-3 to a full-ice 5-on-5 game? And that's a question we get quite often. And if you actually look at the game as they get older, you know, you'll never see in an NHL game 10 guys jamming for the puck in the corner. It always breaks down into 3-on-3 battles all over the ice. So we're actually preparing them for what comes next. Right now, you know, it's not realistic to think that they're going to have 20 feet to skate with the puck before they have to make a decision. And we just don't feel that's really preparing them for what's coming next. Because that's really what this program is. It's building a platform for what comes next for these kids. So the 3-on-3 each side, and we were lucky enough, I love visual things, but we're literally taking this ice surface, and 90% of our ice is right here, which is great. But the two younger ones, we're breaking it down in 65 by 45 feet. And I don't know if any of you guys have backdoor rinks, but a 65 by 45 rink is a great size surface, especially with little guys. We've color-coded all the pads and everything. We make things really easy. We use a lot of neurological principles, especially early youth development principles as far as teaching kids as well. It's not just a matter of splitting up the ice, but really making it a lot of fun, a lot of action. It's a quick game. The way that we're setting these things up too, guys, is especially for the fall, we're going to be doing, it's almost like an extended warm-up where we're going to be doing three zones or three stations where the kids rotate around, the kids are moving all the time, but we're really spending the first 30 minutes to master their fundamental components and their tactical skills as far as skating, stick handling, passing, shooting. And then we're breaking off, and we've got two teams in every playing surface. They're going to play against each other. We're going to team score. End of the year, we're going to have championships. I'm a huge proponent, I'm talking on behalf of the entire coaching staff here, but winning and losing are two equally important things as far as childhood development. We're not a big fan of giving up participation ribbons just for showing up. Not that that's a bad thing, but losing is just as important as a development piece as winning. And those two go hand in hand. Kids have to learn that they got to get ready for the next game. They got to get ready for the next competition. So we're going to spend, there's obviously a huge emphasis on building great athletes, but you know, understanding winning and losing is part of it. As you see on the playing surface, I mean, we talk a lot about just the size, and is there really enough room to have all these kids? And I'm sure you guys have seen even practices where they've had three teams, and it seems like a lot out there. We've just been really fortunate, not only being involved in the game for a long time, but we've actually got a ton of help on the military side. You know, we've got some great people to deal with logistics and moving people and organizing people. We do a ton of work in our other world as far as working with special ops military groups and things like that, where we're going to be incorporating a lot of logistics, a lot of team-based principles and things like that. But as far as moving kids around, all of our rosters are literally 10 players. We're going to play 3-on-3 with a goalie. There's three lines. Usually we'll have an A, B, and a C line. But realistically, there's plenty of room out there for these kids to touch the puck. And it's in a small area where you can't hide or, I don't know, we had, and one of these little guys, we had a media day here, it's almost a month ago. And one of the most amazing things, one of the parents came up to me and he's this little guy, he's been playing for a year and a half, and I guess in the games he doesn't touch the puck yet. And he actually got a goal. And he was like, it was unbelievable. You could literally see, and he wanted to watch the Flames game that night and everything else, and he literally went from being just a participant in the game to an actual player. And to engage kids like that on a daily basis is just something it's a pretty amazing platform to teach kids. So that's what our two youngest levels are going to look like from a structure standpoint. As they get older, we add them to PB kids. Now we move on to a cross ice, a full cross ice. I had a gentleman also talk to me about how, you know, for PB level kids, they should be playing on a bigger surface. And I think all of us can attest to this, even at the NHL level, we were playing on this side surface. Like, in the offseason, this is what we do all the time. It's an unbelievable training platform because you build quicker skills, reaction time, you got to move the puck quicker, all these great things that happen. But there's plenty of room out there, I can assure you, for PB level kids. We're doing it with adults at the highest level. So, but again, same format here, we're going to have six teams. Six teams in the league, and we can move that around, and they're going to be competing against each other, as I said. We've got two on-ice games per week, and then one multi-sport component, which I'll get into after this. But again, there's plenty of room out there. And it's a pretty interesting product. So after we've prepared them, after we've given them all these great skills, exposed them to all these unbelievable coaches, now they're ready to move up. We're not focusing on the systems. We're not focusing on the left wing block or power plays or making kids decide and add them whether they should be a left winger or a defenseman. At that point, we're just mastering fundamental skills and we're teaching them offensive and defensive principles. If you can understand how to create space or how to create offense in a three-on-three component, you can do it anywhere on any size surface. It's the same thing. Same thing defensively. If you can understand that your opponent is there and your net is there and you need to understand what defensive side positioning is, you're going to be able to play any position out there. So we really hammer in on those levels where I think there's a lot of emphasis on these levels. And you'll see kids that literally have not learned the fundamentals yet, but still can't take a pass on their backhand, like myself, that literally learned how to skate when I was with the national team, which is one of the most humbling and frustrating and amazing experiences that I've ever had. To literally, you know, and this was after, yeah, been drafted, after I'd been on a four-year scholarship, and we had a power skating coach come out, take a video, and they're like, "You're doing this wrong, this horribly wrong. I don't know where you learned this." And I was just sitting there watching the video. Like, man, I played at the highest levels in arguably the best country in the world to learn this sport. And I'm learning how to skate now at 24 years old. And as you can imagine, the development you're going to do when you're 24 is not the same when you're 4 and 5 and 6 and 7. So that was a lot of what just this entire program is really a transfer of knowledge to build great athletes when they're starting out. Get them started off, and then allow them to enjoy the game and move on. As far as the multi-sport component, there's a ton of talk about how important this is. There's some key phrases or catch terms from long-term athletic, the LTAD model. A lot of people talk about it. We're actually doing it. We're building it right into the program. And there's volumes of research to show why this is not only important for an athlete to build as a great athlete, but also to become a safer athlete. So this is something that, again, we're going to be focusing on pretty heavily. I mean, Dr. Morski is a great example. You never take a 7-year-old or 8-year-old and walk into school and be like, "Hey, let's bring your teachers in because my son's really good at math. So we'd like you to not teach him any other subjects than just math. We're just going to focus on math right now. We're going to see how well that goes." But, you know, this is what we're doing in sports. And it's not just in hockey. My son goes to school here. He's a snowboarder. He's with the National Sports School. It's amazing how many kids in grade 10, 11 don't know how to throw a ball or catch a ball or kick a ball. And this is something that not only is it limited as an athlete, but just from a safety standpoint, there's a major discrepancy there. And now we get the safety, and these guys know all of it. So my career ended after 6 major concussions. I think all the amount of concussions we had in the front row was probably more than the entire room. And we're all kind of brain damaged, yeah, which is a great thing. We're kind of lucky. And I don't know, have any of your kids showing? Have any of your kids had concussions at all? Yep. So I don't know if you've ever... If you had a concussion, that's one thing. It's actually not a bad injury. You don't really remember much. You just kind of wake up with a headache. But when your child goes down, or if you've had a child you're coaching go down and laying there lifeless on the bench, or if you've had teammates, you know, that have been forced out of the game, or if you've had teammates that have actually taken their lives, this becomes a pretty important piece. And this is something we're definitely passionate about. There's a lot of... I don't think it's hard. Every week there seems to be something new about concussions in the news. I can tell you that from a former player standpoint and someone that's deeply entrenched in this whole industry, there's a lot of awareness that's out there, which is great. I think we had to understand that this is an injury to take seriously. I think when most of us played, Gordon, you're too young, but when the old timers here, when we played, it was just getting your bell rung and you go back in. There was a game where I literally cracked my jaw and played the rest of the game and swung up in the hallway. But at that time, if you could still skate, you just kept playing. So the awareness around it is great. But we're kind of beyond the awareness, because I can tell you as a damaged athlete, you know, wearing a bright colored t-shirt or wearing a bracelet or something doesn't do anything to fix it. And it's not preventing these injuries. And as much as there's a lot of great people doing some good things out there, you know, the reality of what's going on, I love details and I love facts. And Kelly and I were fortunate enough to go to an engineering school. We really like things that are black and white. And when you look at what's happening, you know, despite all the awareness, despite taking hitting out of the game, despite having the best equipment that's ever been available in any history or any other point in history, these rates are going up. So, again, in our secret life and on the research side of what we do, we've been entrenched in this for about 5 years, and we've seen some amazing things happen on the preventative side that are, again, not awareness, but actual preventative solutions. And it really boils down, and Kelly and I have been involved in this for a long time, whether it's high performance, whether it's injury prevention, whether it's recovery, inevitably, all the research that we've done, it always falls back into three different principles. One, how you feel your brain. Two, how you exercise your brain and your body. And number three is how you sleep. And it's amazing how even, I can tell you in my life, in my mid-40s now, I've learned actually how to eat properly, and I've learned how to sleep properly, and I've learned how to freaking exercise properly. And I just can't believe all these fundamental components just haven't been really taught or educated in some way. But there's a really interesting study, not hockey related, that came out last year where the University of right here, they pretty much figured that 70% of all cancers are preventable. And they, you know, they really attributed it to a lot of lifestyle components, which we know from a sleep standpoint, if you're not sleeping, you know, that's the process where your brain recovers and it repairs itself, broken tissue gets damaged, or gets repaired. New cells get prepared. When you're not sleeping properly, you can do all kinds of great things during the day. And you're not gonna get healthy. But to educate and empower these kids and families with preventive, I mean, the kids won't even know any different anyway. They're just up there playing. But to start building these lifestyles and these principles early on, something's gonna carry with them for the rest of their lives. But we spend a lot of time on, it's not only solution-based research, but preventative measures. And you'll see kind of what we're talking about here. Now this is something that, this is like bringing all the best things that we've learned through hockey and literally putting them into the most fundamental basic entry level kids, your kids. But we're taking a very scientific approach to this whole thing. And again, it's just awareness, it's education, but it's empowerment, and it's giving people knowledge that they can use. It's relevant knowledge, it's not selfish. I'm not going to have any impact on the world, but we actually have four different analyses that are included in this program. This is an area that I kind of like. I'm kind of the dorky guy on this whole thing. I like science and I like numbers. But we're doing full neurological assessments with the kids. This is going to be one of the first pediatric brain scanning protocols that even exists in the world. And this is something that's going to be done right here with Dr. Benson. It's unbelievable. It's one thing to just not talk about brain injuries or not worry about it or not think that your kid is going to ever get hurt. But the great thing is, especially here, part of this program, you've got a clinic right here on site. And you've got one of the leading neurologists in the world, really, to help through that as far as not only preventing the injury from hopefully not happening, but if it does happen, you've got unbelievable support here. And support that most people would die for in the game. That's the first one. Then we have a biomechanical assessment, which Kelly and I'm sorry, I keep picking my part. But we actually went through, and we like using ourselves as guinea pigs as much as we can. But as far as getting blood analysis, just understanding if there's any deficiencies from minerals, vitamins, things like that. It's just a finger prick. It's not like the kids are going to be strapped up and, you know, a full, it's just literally a finger prick. But again, from a parent standpoint, I'm kind of excited about it. I've never had it done with my four kids. But just understand if there are any deficiencies to identify them young. Same thing with biomechanical assessment. I can't even stress, you know, I don't even know when you're starting up how many chiropractors were even around, but we've got a gentleman here, Dr. Greg Ushas, who's worked with the Canadian Olympic team. Like this thing, we're bringing just some amazing people engaged in these kids' lives. But Dr. Greg's been involved with the Olympic team for gosh, over 12 years now, but he's providing a full functional movement assessment, just make sure their hips and spines are where they need to be and growing in a normal manner. unbelievable the difference that you can make when you can actually find a child that is a little bit tweaked and make some minor adjustments when they're young and just allow them. It's a life-changing experience for people that are doing that. But again, if you've never been through it, it's tough to really know. We've got another colleague of ours who lives down in New Jersey. He's a first-round pick in Quebec, a good friend of mine, 43 years old right now. He literally can't go up and down stairs. And his hips were so jacked up and he got hit pretty hard in Bantam, he got hit even harder in Midget, never got fixed, never got treated. You know, it was a macho thing, and he just played through it. And anyway, we want to make sure that that's not the case for these kids. And then the last thing is the hockey combines. And this is really a lot of the basis of our evaluation. Our coaches are going to be out there watching these kids, but we are going to assess. It's more of an assessment. It's just understanding where your child is at any given point. We use a laser timer here, so it's not just some subjective test. It's very objective. We're going to be doing skills and skating tests. Typically, 90% of the player placement can be determined off of those tests. But again, there's things that we're going to be watching to really put the kids in. You know, a good coach can usually place a kid. They're either going to be a one, a two, or a three. One, they're going to be unbelievable. Two, they're pretty much where they need to be. And three, they might be a little bit behind. But that's really what we're going to be setting up the teams. We're not spending 3 weeks in evaluations, seeing moms and dads getting stressed out of their mind. That, unfortunately, if you guys do enjoy that part of the year, it's not going to be part of the staff. But there's some people, I guess, that really do enjoy the punishment. But we're trying to eliminate all the nonsense in hockey. And really just make it all about the kids and get them playing, get them playing, build some great athletes and some great experiences. As you said, the kids won't understand or even care about any of this, but for you guys as parents, I think it's a really cool, not from a baseline standpoint, but just to see and listen, hold us accountable. You know, are we really developing these kids? Are they moving forward every year or are they moving backwards? And, you know, part of my frustration and passion in this whole thing is, I'm not sure if you've had a great experience every time you've been involved in hockey, but I really have, and I struggle as a parent to put my child in an environment where you just don't know whether they're going to progress or not. Now we get to the coaches. So, as I was saying, you know, the current model, which I equate to being basically a lottery system, you just sit there during those evaluations, like, oh my God, I have to get a good coach. Hope you get a good coach. Go on, give me a good coach. And then you have no idea what's going on. And now we know exactly where our coaches are next year. You know where your coaches are the year after, the year after, the year after. And I can tell you that, you know, even at most associations, just within the same level, it's tough to get guys that are on the same page and working together. Like collaboration just is non-existent in this world. It's just strange. So what we've done, and it's amazing how many coaches that we do have on board right now, the collaboration is just amazing. We've all learned to be completely different. In different parts of the country, different parts of the world, and to come together and really take all the knowledge that we've amassed over the last, it's really, I think our combined experience is over 100 years of pro and Olympic playing experience. But to take that knowledge and experience and literally inject it into these kids when they're just starting out, it's just going to be amazing to see what happens here. But the coaches that we have are amazing. It's one thing to be a player, it's another thing to be a coach. It's another thing to actually teach to different age levels. You don't just take an NHL drill and water it down for a five-year-old. We take a lot of pride and invest a lot of time in understanding early childhood development, understanding biomechanical function, understanding how the brain works and how it works really well. Part of the reason we're even only doing these things three times a week is because of the rest and recovery component, which is a huge aspect as far as skill acquisition. And it's not just, you know, there's three components as far as framing or introducing a new skill, and then you get into an association and repetition of it, and then you finally get to a point where it's an autonomic or it's subconscious where you're doing things without even thinking of it. But to get to that component, you don't start. You have to start, there's certain ways that the brains learn, there's certain age-specific windows that we're really training towards. But I gotta tell you, and again, the kids won't know any different, we're just teaching them. But there's a lot of science and a lot of experience behind what we're doing. We're taking having fun and developing kids pretty seriously. But we've got an amazing group. Yeah, here's the kind of the mindset. And this is something that comes out of experience. And I think you guys know, and moms used to be a great example, childbirth. Can you imagine if, I don't know, my sister-in-law was about to have her first baby, and then she was going to ask someone what that childbirth experience was like, and she decided to ask me instead of my wife. And I was trying there to tell her what childbirth was like. To me, that's when I walk in and I see some of these coaches that are teaching kids that just have no clue. The same way that you or my wife would look at me is what we've been seeing with coaches. And what we're trying to do now with our guys, more than anything, is take our experience and build a mindset. It's not trying to win games. It's doing what's fundamentally right for these kids to overcome challenges, understand when things go sideways, and they will in life. That you absolutely get up. You get knocked down 9 times, get up a 10th time. Chris Cedarstrand is not here today. He just exemplifies this in so many different ways, and our adaptive athletes in general. But even, you know, we had a media day here where we had our sledge hockey kids out with the stand-up kids. But listen, when you go through a traumatic injury like that, to not only get back up, but to come back at life and go at it even harder is just something. You know, we're missing a lot of different areas, and this is something that we absolutely take seriously. But the mindset of going after and really coming in and approaching this in three ways is, how can I make the game better? How can I make those around me better? And how can I make myself better? But that team first, those team first principles and understanding that this is bigger than them and that there is no challenge that they can't overcome, and understanding that those team principles in life that are going to carry with them far beyond the ice rink. But this is something we take really seriously, and it's something we live by. And it's just, it's great when you have role models, living examples, working with the kids one-on-one. You know, we joke that this is, and some of you guys may remember, there was a Howie Meeker hockey school when we were growing up. Well, you never saw Howie Meeker. He never showed up. But they had the Howie Meeker school going on everywhere. Our pro athletes are actually on the ice, and actually engaged in working with the kids. And it's an amazing group of human beings that we have that are selfless enough that want to take, you know, the sidestep and really move this into the kids and empower them as much as we possibly can. The mindset of being a warrior versus a winner. Listen, you can cheat and get your way and win a game, but to be a warrior and constantly compete and constantly be there and constantly be ready to battle and back each other up, that's something that's going to carry with them forever. And that's a mindset that we want. We want them absolutely thriving in competition. And you see that in everything we do. So the schedule, how many of you guys actually have multiple children? Anybody have more than one? Yeah, great. So I've got 4, my wife and I, and we're always shorthanded. I got to tell you, I mean, this is part of the, there's a lot of passion, a lot of frustration that goes into this program. But frustration drove this one completely. So with 4 kids, like swimming is awesome, gymnastics, set times, set days. And I'm sure you guys know, when it comes to hockey, man, it is just all over the map. And I don't know of a more disruptive aspect in my family's life. And it kills me that people are getting turned away from the game because of this. And, you know, when I'm mad that we have to go to hockey again, or, you know, I just found out when you guys are on playdowns in the playoffs right now, you know, we've every night at 11 o'clock, we're waiting to find out when our next event is. It could be tomorrow, it could be the next day. I just think it's insane, and especially for young kids. And as far as building routine in their lives, as far as building recovery components, as far as building family life into it, you know, can you imagine having 4 nights a week to actually be a family and do things? And whether that is just, listen, if you want to get more hot, go to an outdoor room. Have some fun out there. Go skiing. Take some music lessons. You know, the one component I wish we had in this was actually music lessons. It's unbelievable what that does for athletics. I mean, teaching rhythm, teaching timing. There's so many different things you can do as a family, too. You know, we really want to build strong families out of this community and out of this program. It's a big, important piece. And I find not always, you know, not only eating horribly because you're always trying to grab something, Tim Hortons or McDonald's or something, you're just it's more survival than actually living. And we want families to thrive in this program. So this is a big part of it. Weeknights, we are going to have one hockey and one multi-sport. We're limited on the weeknight hours, you know, making 4:30 to basically 8:45. On the weekends, we've got plenty of ice for everybody. But the way that we're looking at it right now, which can change, we're going to finalize everything as we get closer. But the way we're looking at it is, as boys would be Monday, Wednesday, Saturday, the girls' program would be Tuesday, Thursday, Sunday, all year. Set times, like you can set your watch on, and you can actually go on vacation, and you can enjoy parts of the city. There is no travel out of town. Listen, hotels don't let kids play mini sports anymore. I'm going to go swim with the team, and Southside Leisure Center is awesome. I'm going to go to a Roughnecks game. Enjoy parts of the city that are going on and support this community locally. Absolutely get out and do that. But you have that opportunity for Fridays. We will have some specialized, we'll have some makeup days too. Like I have to tell you, the nice thing is we know the schedule right off the bat, but with Halloween, I think it's on Monday, so we've kind of shifted all the programming one day. But there's certain holidays and things that happen where we will be using the Fridays as well. But you guys are going to know everything before we even get started, which is just exciting. This is one of the best parts, selfishly, in my mind. The fact that they're all here, you're never going to go to the wrong rink. I don't know if you guys have done that. I've done that a number of times. You show up, but you don't have to worry about that at all. And as far as the no volunteering, no fundraising, I don't know how you guys are with that as well. Maybe that's a component if you want to do a bottle drive or do that. We're just one of the families that just pays a check. And gosh, we've got so many other things going on. We really do value your time. And to have 3 nights here, there's unbelievable facilities. There's a track around here. We've talked about actually doing some parent training. If you don't like the training, there's Molson House just a couple doors down. So you can actually watch a beer and watch the thing. So you're kind of at both ends of the spectrum of whatever you want to do. But it's a beautiful facility to come in and to be part of. There's Olympic athletes training here, future Olympians training here. It's a really, it's an amazing facility. But, and again, this is set up right up to the Pee Wee level. At the Pee Wee second year level, just put any questions of these. We will look at doing some 5-on-5 tournaments, some spring tournaments and things like that to help them transition into the banking years. But up until then, I just have not seen any sites that would support not having them playing in a 3-on-3 format and playing more, to travel halfway across the city or halfway across the province to get your 9 minutes of ice time and touch the puck for 7 seconds. Just doesn't make sense anymore. And we had a big tipping point this year in Golden. We went up, I don't know if this has happened to you guys as well, but we went up there to play all Calgary teams. And then we played against our association other team in the championship. So I spent the entire weekend with my 4 kids up in Golden to play local teams. And to have the kids yell that for running the hallways, and I don't see the point. Not that age. So, again, a lot of passion, a lot of frustration, but this is a really exciting program. Not only is it important to learn through these development windows and learning the proper way, you learn the proper grip, you learn the proper stance. You don't have to go and defrag and relearn. It may take a child 100 hours to master a skill. If they've learned it properly, it's going to take them 300 hours. Maybe even 400, because you have to defrag all the damage and bad wiring, get them to a neutral spot, and then actually start programming properly. So every year that we go through this, and this is again part of the frustration that I've had with my child, is when they're not even being shown the right things or they're not being taught the right things, it's really hard to dewire that. And the older that they get, the tougher it becomes. I cannot emphasize how important it is at the earliest ages to get proper coaching. They take so many visual cues too. If you can't even demonstrate the drill properly, or if you don't even, you only teach what you know. I can't hold coaches. Thank God they're out there helping these kids, because we wouldn't even have a game of fools with these volunteers. But to really develop proper motor skills, proper neurological function, and all these things that we're talking about, you really need some high-level people that know what they're doing. And, you know, our coaches are not only teaching kids. We are going to have a mentorship program with coaches as well. We do want to have dads out there. This is not about us, I can tell you that. We do want to teach. This is a teaching platform for all the levels of hockey. And eventually, we're going to be bringing people from other parts of the country to literally train them on how to run this system and this program. So this center is going to be a center of innovation. It's going to have all the top coaches. It's going to have all the top doctors. I don't think many people are going to go to the extent that we have. But when you have all these resources available to you here, it'd be crazy not to capitalize on them. So your kids, hopefully, being part of this, are going to get exposed to really the best of the best. And like I said, it's an exciting time. We couldn't be more excited. It's amazing that it's taken this long for a program like this to get started. But gosh, we wouldn't be here without you guys. Hopefully you can be part of this. I'm done with my presentation. Hopefully, does that answer a lot of the questions or some of the questions? But it's really exciting. And anyway, why don't we open it up question-wise? We can either just do this in open forum, or we got all these coaches again that have been here. You know, this may be a new program. I can tell you that none of these guys are new to hockey. They've been at this for a long, long time. And it's exciting to finally bring everybody together as well. But, questions?
So one of my kids two of my kids are competitive gymnasts, and they're 20 hours next year. So timing-wise, even if I can make that up in the morning, is there enough recovery time? So they do 4 hours, 5 days a week. If I cut them out to come for 90 minutes of hockey, right, dress, undress, and back, and then do a morning training to make it up, is that going to be something they can handle at 10 years old, 9 years old?
Well, there's a couple of things. I think there's more variables than just the activities. I think sleep health is a big thing. If you're feeding them really well, and if they're sleeping really well, we've had people learn how to actually sleep, getting electronics. So, and all of this stuff I've learned firsthand. And I literally was on my laptop till wee hours, put the sports center on. You know, we have no electronics in our room anymore. You know, understanding how to eat properly, sleep, getting deep quality sleep as well. And sleep is just paramount for these little guys. I mean, if they're getting enough sleep, and kids are going to be active. I don't think it's a bad thing to be active, especially if you're exposing them to different disciplines and exposing them to different sports. If it was just hockey, I would highly recommend not doing it. Right. But to expose them to a different sport, I think that's great. Yep.
So on that note, when you do the blood test, is that just once, or you do it maybe halfway or twice a year?
We include it once a year. Okay. You'll have exposure to all these people if you do want to do it again. I mean, we've got a family that does it monthly, which I think is a little extreme, but it depends what you've been through, right? I mean, if you've lost people because of certain diseases, you know, you're probably a little more intense on it. But even once a year, to me, is a big step up from what we're doing. And as you know, listen, the program's not $500. I mean, it's $3,000. We didn't want to make it $5,000 or $10,000 or $15,000, which a lot of programs that are out there. But I think for what we're providing, we wanted to at least give a baseline. So the skeletal assessment, the blood analysis, and the neurological analysis, those are done once a year. The on-ice testing is done at pre and post, so at the start and end of each year.
Yeah. Why do you separate boys and girls?
Boys are smelly and dumb, there's actually, we are going to have some, like there's some families that actually have two boys and one girl, and they've asked if they could, you know, put them all in one. Which absolutely, I mean, that's the nice thing about having a private program too, is we can actually, inject some common sense into things, and we want the family coming here 3 nights a week instead of six. So, but the girls learn at a different rate, and
because that could fix some scheduling issues for the other person too.
Yeah, definitely.
Right.
Yeah. And listen,
we'll accommodate.
Yeah, we'll accommodate. I mean, the main thing is, though, like we've got a lot of strong women that are going to be coming into this program too. Kaylee Humphries is a great ambassador. But we want girls to have their own voice in this program. And, starting off, it's not as big of a factor, but they are maturing at different rates. And neurologically, they're actually a lot farther ahead of us in a lot of different ways. But teaching is a little bit different for girls than it is for boys. But we want to bring in female coaches. We've got some great alumni on the female side as well. They'll be helping out. But we want to give them their own voice and their own platform.
So I got two questions. So I got a four-year-old, which for going into attendance, this would be like perfect. I'm definitely a customer right off of the bat for the younger guys. What's your thoughts on, as the program gets new, I also have a nine-year-old who's going to Adam next year, about paddling and playing against like the elite players, right? Playing against the best players and all that stuff, that as the program gets new, you're likely not to get the entire market share of that right away, right? So. Playing against players of equal, so you guys are going to break them out into scale level, but you might get the best of the best to start with, right?
No, and you know what's interesting? And I'm kind of jealous your son's 4 years old, I just want to do it before. But right now, I can tell you to sign up. Our guys are team 1, 2, 3. I mean, at the Adam and PB levels, it's all tough. Or I would say people that are playing at the top level right now. Right. And I think, once you, at the older age groups, you're going to kind of migrate towards where the better coaching is. So I think it kind of, like this obviously isn't a Parks and Recs program. I mean, yeah. It's a pretty high-end deal. And I think it's attracting a more high-end player. Right. That's what we're seeing right now.
And on that note as well, as far as competition and games,
yes.
Is it really the most important focus at that age? Right? Like,
definitely not.
It should be, if you look at other programs, well, you use the ADM model in the USA, it should be at least a 6-to-1 practice to game ratio.
Right.
We're tweaking that a little, obviously, a lot. We're more of a 1-to-1 essentially on a day.
I'd like to think that the 3-on-3 hockey, it is a practice. I mean, we're just practicing the entire time.
Which was the follow-up to that then? Like, the idea would be that if you're playing a lot of 3-on-3, that there might be something broken with the current system. Yet, I know that's more of a European model on the 3-on-3, but we're still producing the best teams at the highest levels, right? I mean, Canada's still winning.
Yes and no.
The junior and
no. At the U16, U17, U18 level now, we are losing.
In the last 15 years.
And if you look at, if you look at that trend, it's changed because there's a reason behind it. And it's because of the implementation of a better skill development platform, which is the USA Hockey Media model.
Yeah, the killer, we've gone from over 90%, and this is obviously, we're not just a little hockey factory here, but just one of the telltale signs. The NHL, we used to have over 90% Canadian-born players in the NHL. We just broke the 50% mark last year, around 49%. Since the USA Hockey has implemented the cross ice, they've gone from 12% to 25% in the same period. And they're just there's actually more kids registered in the US.
The game's grown down there too, right? So you're likely to have a lot more registration and playing, so you're going to.
But it's fun, right? Even like when you're engaged in the sport, it's, and that's one of the studies that we're doing, sorry, Steve, is that Brian Benson's really excited about is we're actually going to follow the kids for 4 years post the AMP program. Because right now, at that adolescent age, the band of midget, we're losing almost 70% of our players. Like, if you would put your child into an elementary school that's only seeing 30% of them going to high school, that's not a good model. And we want to see if you, we just have, I don't know, call it a suspicion or anything else, but we just believe if you're more proficient in the skills and you're enjoying the game more, you're probably going to play it more. Plus, if you're not hurt as often as well, I think it's going to be really telling to show how many kids stay engaged in. And I mean, that's really what this program is. It's setting them up. You know, when they go from a 3-on-3, which is just like hyper hockey on how fast it is, to a slower model. You know, the current model, you're going from a slow model to a faster model. We're actually completely changing that, where they're going to have a lot more success once they do that transition. But I think we're going to see a lot more people involved in the game, a lot more people staying in the game, and a lot more people that have the basis to actually move up and do some great things in the game. But we're trying to, and we're kind of competitive too. Most of us are kind of quiet, but a little bit competitive. But the U.S. model, all they did was literally cut the ice in half, and they went 5-on-5. We're obviously not doing 5-on-5. There's still left wingers that are out there never touching a puck in the game, or getting maybe one shot in the game. You can't hide in this program. Like, you're absolutely engaged. switch, and you're touching the puck and you're developing. I mean, that 5-on-5 model that Mr. Pinkson was looking at, he's basically said in the 5-on-5 format, especially with young kids, that shouldn't be NHL ball. Guys aren't touching the puck for more than 85 seconds of a game, the entire game. He's like, it would be, you'd need about 180 games to have the development equivalent of one solid hour of skill development. 180. So, I don't know, I just think there's a better, that's the thing, when you've seen there's a better model, and you've seen science, and you've seen this happen, this isn't something that they just started last year, or the Europeans started, but when you can engage and start working on the skill development that's out there, but bring in the mindset of, I would like to think, a Canadian mindset, and a Canadian grit into that involvement, I think we're just going to have amazing results with this. Is that fair?
Yep.
Yeah, and on that note, I've spent the last 16 years in Southern California watching the growth of hockey there, and they're producing first-round draft picks out of California more than any other state, I think, in the U.S. And there's a reason why they've implemented these types of principles into their organizations and communities. And the Ducks and the Junior Kings have done an amazing job with what we're talking about, providing the best coaching and the best platform. It's all ex-NHL players that have played the game and end up staying back there. And they've had kids, they've got involved in the programs, they're running the programs, and they're running them properly.